So Trevor, if you don't mind, will you just tell us a little bit about the individuals we'll be speaking with today?
Yes. So the individuals you all will be speaking to is students who are either A, pursuing healthcare, they're seeking a healthcare career, or they're in their healthcare program currently. So you may be speaking to students who are in our nursing program, our PT program, our OT program, or you may be speaking to our students who may be in their prerequisites before they even venture off into a program or consider a program after they graduate with their bachelor's degree. So you'll kind of be speaking with an intermediate level audience, but also to a beginner's level audience.
Perfect. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for asking that question. Hello, Tammy. How are you? I think you're on mute.
There we go. Can you hear me?
Yes, Pam. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing pretty well. Awesome. We will be getting started shortly. I know we are waiting on Miss Mia. Okay. Have you had a conversation with her? I know both of you all work for. Okay. No. Well, I just can give her a few seconds or a few minutes, and then we'll get started shortly. But thank you all for being here, by the way. And for our students who are currently logged in, please feel free to share your name and your program that you're currently enrolled in, and also to your current interest, to provide a synopsis of the populations that our students are representing for our panelists. I think that'd be really great to inform them of who's obviously represented within the student audience. And then also to, you know, obviously who they can speak to for the targeted audience. So again, please feel free to utilize the chat box, and we'll be getting started shortly. All righty, so we're gonna go ahead and get started. We do have one more panelist who should be on the way. So we're just gonna just have her jump in. But I do wanna thank you all for being here and sharing this opportunity in this space to have further dialogue out here. Here's our fourth panelist. So give me 1 second. Hello, Mia. Welcome. How are you?
There we go. Thank you. I heard you speaking, but for some reason it was glitching out on me here. I'm doing well.
How are you? I'm doing well. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Today, my co-partner, Olivia Hayes, the Houston Career Consultant, will actually be moderating this panel today. But I just want to say thank you all and thank you to the panelists for being able to share your expertise, your wisdom, and also to your knowledge of the particular industry that you'll be representing today. And so again, this particular women's healthcare panel kind of came about. This kind of came about last semester, spring semester. I was thinking about how can I really target our women and male population, but specifically just be tailored to those particular populations. And so I really just wanted something near and dear and for it to be a space for our students who may identify as female or other students who may want to learn more about females within the healthcare industry. To have a space to learn more about this particular population and gender. And so I'm going to pass it over to Olivia Hayes, our career consultant in Houston, to further moderate this panel, to share it for you all, to share some more wisdom and expertise with our students today.
All right, thank you. And as he mentioned, my name is Olivia Hayes. I currently serve as the Houston Career Consultant. And so on behalf of the Career Connection Center, we want to say thank you for being here and sharing this opportunity, not only with us, but with our students. And so just a little bit about myself in the population of students that I service. I work with students who are nursing, PT, OT, as well as healthcare administration or MBA. And so very excited to be sharing this space. As Trevor mentioned, if you came in a little late, if you could go ahead and place your name in the chat box, as well as your area of interest, or maybe even what your current major is. And so then, of course, if you have any questions, you can also place those in the chat box as well. But we do have some panelist questions that we're going to be asking. And so the first question, and so whoever wants to answer, the first question is going to be, what does it mean to be a female in healthcare? And so whomever wants to go ahead and answer first, you can just unmute yourself. And this is a relaxed environment, a relaxed, chill space. We're all women. So what does it mean to be a female in healthcare?
Go ahead and answer this one. Okay, so I think that being a female in healthcare means bringing about a diverse workforce that can meet the needs of a community as a whole. So the experiences of our patients, they have an impact on who they want to be treated by, who they're comfortable being treated by. And by having females in the healthcare field, then we ensure that those patients or those, communities have the ability to choose a provider that really understands their needs and that can meet their needs.
You know, I'm actually, before we get into everything, I'm sorry, I didn't even allow you guys to introduce yourselves, to even say like who you are and what you guys do in the field of healthcare. So Mia, if you would like to just briefly introduce yourself, just say your name and also explain like your role or the industry that you are currently in.
Sure. So my name is Mia Bashir. So I'm a pediatric occupational therapist. I've specialized in working with children from undergrad all the way to my graduate school, went to TWU. So still here in pediatrics and loving it.
Okay, is it Kamisha?
Yes. Hi everyone, I'm Kamisha Francis. So I'm actually an active duty Navy healthcare administrator. I have a subspecialty in financial management. I've been here now for about a year and a half. So before coming here, I was working in a Navy clinic in North Carolina. And in order for me to get here, I kind of had to go outside of my profession, so to speak. So I'm a talent scout. And right now I recruit basically like medical professionals. So from doctors, nurses to allied health and everything in between.
Okay, Jennifer.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jennifer Jones. I am a nurse by background. I've been a nurse for about 13 years now. Started my career as a NICU nurse and then really quickly progressed into education and leadership. So over the last 9 years, I've served as a manager, an educator, a director, and now the administrative director, which is like an AVP for a company for education. So happy to be here with you guys and just help share any insight that we can in healthcare.
Thank you. Tammy?
All right, I'm Tammy. I am a pediatric physical therapist in the home health setting. I also did my DPT at Texas Women's in Dallas. So nice to be back to contribute.
Thank you so much. And so now that we have formally introduced ourselves, Kamisha, if you would like to go next and just say, what does it mean to be a female in healthcare?
So for me, my perspective is similar to what Mia just mentioned, but also being in the Navy and Navy healthcare, it's for me, it's very common to see a lot of females in most of our facilities, whether it's in the hospitals or clinics. So I just never really felt like, you know, being a female in the environment hindered me. I know that is not the case for a lot of people, or some people, I wouldn't say a lot, especially with those who don't really have a support network. And that could go for anyone, not just females, but just in my experience, sometimes we have to juggle a lot of responsibilities from family to personal to professional. So it can be a little stressful, but just having that support network, there are a lot of other women, at least from where I've worked to where, you know, I always had someone I could talk to and lean on. And I think it's good, you know, having that in your work environment so that you can kind of, when you deal with the patients, they could see that, you know, they could kind of tell when you're stressed. So having someone there to kind of get those frustrations out, that's helpful.
Thank you. And I know that also too, you know, working in the military setting could definitely be overwhelming. So I'm excited to hear about some of your experiences as we go down and matriculate throughout the different questions. And so Jennifer, would you like to go next?
Ma'am, thank you. So I think being a female in healthcare for me, especially in nursing, which is predominantly female, has been, you know, a really great journey. I really felt like I've been able to connect with a lot of my peers, regardless of the setting, you know, from my bedside practice in the NICU to being an educator in leadership. I feel like there's a lot of people that you can kind of develop that second family and camaraderie with. At the same time, I do see that there's a lot of disparity as far as the community that we serve, because a lot of nurses are female. So obviously we don't have as much diversity as we need. We need a lot more male and, you know, multiple generations and multiple ethnicities in healthcare, specifically in nursing. And the last thing I'd say is, from my experience in executive leadership, I feel that as females, we often have to strive a little harder to really make an executive presence, because I think when you get up into executive leadership in healthcare, a lot of times there is a disparity between your chief nursing officers who are maybe largely female, but then some of your other healthcare sectors like your CEOs, your CFOs, a lot of times are a lot of males. And so I think that power struggle at times is there. Whereas females, you have to work very diligently to have that executive presence and influence in that environment. That just takes practice in my experience and building those relationships.
Great. Tammy, did you want to add to anything?
It seems like most of it's already been covered very similarly, but I will add, I mean, in the agency that I'm with is obviously primarily women, being in home health pediatrics and physical therapy in general is dominated by the female population. I do also work PRN at a hospital though, and I can say that there is a noticeable difference being a female in the hospital setting versus the home health setting, whereas a lot of patients, you know, might be bigger, and doctors don't always communicate as well with the, you know, female therapist as a male therapist, especially when it's like the older male doctors that aren't necessarily, oh, you're not strong enough to do this, or you don't understand where I'm coming from. Or a lot of times there are male patients that want nothing to do with the female because, you know, they have their own opinion, just like any other, you know, whether it's gender, race, or some other diversity issue, you know, they tend to choose who they want to work with or who they don't want to work with. So I see it more in the hospital setting I work in than in the home health setting, for sure.
Wow, this, and we're going to get into some DEI like initiatives and questions here shortly, but just to kind of talk off script, since we are talking about DEI, when you say that, you know, those are some of the things that you've experienced in your field, what would you, I guess you could say, what would you explain to an upcoming, or how would you guys explain to the upcoming generation who are wanting to go into these fields about DEI? You know, are there conversations that are being had about DEI that you guys, you know, are aware of? Are you a part of the conversation? You know, the DEI conversations that are being had at your prospective, you know, workspaces?
So I will say that our company, and that goes with Mia as well, they have a statement, a DEI statement of inclusion, like as part of the, you know, like, what is the word I'm looking for? Essentially the company theme, like they just want everybody to feel included and wanted and everything, all of the above. It's not something that we talk about every day because it's just kind of the culture that our company has. It's just, you know, like we don't, you know, try to put anybody out, or we have, I've found recently that we lost a recruit because of a race issue. She was nervous about going into homes in the pediatric setting because she didn't know what kind of in the home health setting, I'm sorry, she didn't know what kind of support system she would have if there was an issue with race in the home and how she was treated in the home. What could anybody do? Because we go by ourselves into a home. There's no telling what a parent would say, a brother, a sibling, a nurse that might be working with the same child, like, you know, anybody, any other provider that might be in the home, you know, as obviously, like, you know, I don't necessarily represent that population very well, but there are plenty of people that do. And we unfortunately lost a very qualified physical therapist, you know, because she wasn't comfortable knowing that she would have the support that she needed in case those kind of situations came up. So I mean, that part's unfortunate, but I know that our company does strive to be all inclusive. So,
okay. Did anyone else want to add to that before we move on to the next question? No? Okay. So the next question that we have for you all is, what has your career journey been like as a female? And what are some of the challenges or benefits you have faced being a female in your area? And I can repeat the question if you guys would like.
So I guess I'll take this one. So my journey has been pretty interesting because I transfer every 3 years. And just being in the military is very transient. So people always come and go. And in two of my organizations, which is a benefit, I had an opportunity to rotate to different departments. So it was similar to a residency, which gave me like different experiences in the different departments. So which led to me ultimately choosing to get a subspecialty in financial management. So I've worked in hospitals, clinics, and even a military training facility as well. And thankfully, I never really had significant issues, nothing that required like a formal complaint or anything of that nature. But I have had irritating situations where it's like, you know, maybe someone would make an assumption that, oh, maybe she would be too sensitive for this, or can she handle this personality type? Because some of our locations, not to generalize, but you, depending on the population that you work with, like, some of the tougher military branches, we tend to have more of the gruff personalities. So some women can't really handle dealing with those issues. I would think that's probably more of a challenge. for me, luckily, I never ran into any issue where I felt like just being a woman in healthcare was a hindrance for me. But the benefits, again, would be just having the opportunity to move around, try different things, learn different specialties, and being able to subspecialize. It's just networking with a lot of people, civilians and military, because we have a large group of civilians that work with us as well. So again, that's basically all. I can start rambling, but yeah, that's it for that question.
Was there anyone else that would like to go?
I can go. I don't feel that it, I guess in my career, you know, being a pediatric occupational therapist, I think it's been pretty favorable for me. I don't feel that my gender has affected my like employment prospects, my salary, or my opportunities for promotions, because specifically with occupational therapy, it's predominantly led by females. And so I think that that has been a benefit. But I, you know, I can't speak for every other field. I just feel that specifically in my field, I don't feel that I have faced many challenges or disparities in my workplace.
Okay. Thank you. And once again, for our attendees, if you guys have any questions, you guys can go ahead and place those questions in the chat box. And so if there are, you know, questions that you may want to ask to a specific person, you know, that's fine as well. But definitely if you have any questions that you guys want to ask personally, go ahead and place those in the chat box as we are having this dialogue. And so the next question that I'm going to ask is that, what are the statistics of females in the area of healthcare or in your area of healthcare? So for example, you know, what are the statistics of, you know, women or just females actually becoming physical therapists or actually going into leadership? And so whomever wants to go ahead and, you know, just answer that question, you guys can kind of just jump in.
Kind of like I said, with occupational therapy, I mean, females are the chief healthcare providers in this specific area. And in doing research on the statistics, it's estimated that about 80% of occupational therapists are female. So we definitely lead in this area. Even in my, I remember in my class, I think there were 4 males out of the entire occupational therapy class. So yeah, we take the lead on this one.
This is Jennifer again. So from the nursing side, I would just echo what Mia said. It's very similar in nursing, as you guys might imagine. So a lot of predominant women as bedside nurses, as well as leaders, all the way up to executive leadership in nursing.
And for us, I'm a healthcare administrator. I would say as a whole, we are probably closer to 50-50. I think males may have a win on that or a lead. If you break it down to like some of the other specialties, because for us, we can kind of specialize in different areas, you'll tend to find that one specialty may lean more towards female or male. Like at facilities planning, is you see a lot of guys in that subspecialty. But as a whole, we're about half and half.
Okay. And so thank you for that. And we actually do have a question that was just placed in the chat box, kind of going along with, you know, the male female ratio. And it says, in a medical setting, do you have trouble with ageism at all, including male and female workers?
So from my point of view, perspective, in the home health setting, we have the opportunity, like if anybody's ever out, we cover for each other because it's not like a clinic where, you know, oh, we'll just step to that other bed. So we go to somebody else's home. So we get to hear a lot of stories about it. And I will say a lot of the more seasoned therapists, their families love them. And I can tell you, it's like all the experience that they have, they know all the tricks in the book. So I don't think there's really any you know, concerns with having an older therapist versus a younger therapist. So some people have the point of view that the younger therapists are more up to date on the research or like the new ways of treating versus, you know, the older therapists that might be stuck in their own ways. So I think it's a happy, like a nice balance when you find that person that's keeping up with all the things, but, you know, the experience helps you add on to it. So at least that's what I've heard feedback from as far as our clientele has given us. That being said, I've also been in the hospital setting where my senior therapist was asked to leave the room because they didn't think she'd be able to lift them and they were too afraid to let her work with them. So there's, I guess, that perspective as well. You know, I mean, anybody could say that. I had a 4'10" roommate in college and that little thing could lift anything. So it's all perspective. And I mean, it really comes down to the people you're working with. So.
This is Jennifer. So I'll just add to that from the nursing side. I really do think that, especially from the patient perspective, as well as from our fellow nurses, nurse colleagues that you work with, there are quite a lot of opinions as far as our differences in our age groups. So over the last several years, we've had quite a big shortage of nursing, which started before COVID, and it's even more exacerbated now, as I'm sure a bunch of our panelists will probably attest to in their healthcare fields as well. But we've got a lot of new nurses, you know, that are coming into the profession. Occasionally there are patients that are skeptical about that because they look younger and so they question their expertise and their knowledge. And so one of the things that we try to do from an education perspective is really have them speak to their talents and introducing themselves at the bedside so that, you know, even if they've only been in nursing a few months or maybe a few years, they can highlight one particular skill or thing that they do know or that they are good at that gives them some rapport with their patients. In addition, I would say, you know, at times just different generations in healthcare, especially in nursing, we see that some of our older nurses feel, you know, that the younger nurses aren't as committed to an organization because we know that our millennials are looking for those opportunities to kind of grow and just kind of test out the waters, right? To see where their fit and their heart is, which is okay. But it's very different from the way a lot of our older generational nurses have addressed their careers, right? So they've gone into an organization and they've committed to that organization for 20, 30 years of their life. So there are a lot of generational differences in perspectives when it comes to our age ranges, I would say, in nursing.
So I do have a question, you know, kind of piggybacking, Jennifer, off of what you stated, because I, you know, of course, I do work with our nursing students. And so that ageism has been a topic, because of course in nursing programs or just even in programs in general, you have, you know, those age gaps. So what would you say to a student that, you know, they're in the process of getting ready to graduate, they feel a little bit, you know, they may feel discouraged or they may feel down because of their age, you know, what would you say to kind of lift their spirits a little bit as they would prepare for their interviews?
Yeah, no, thanks for that, Olivia. I think the best thing to do, again, is just preparing those examples. They may seem really small, but any experience that, you know, a nurse student has had in school that has been impactful to them or in their personal life that really draws them into the profession of nursing is a good one to help connect with people, because that's something anybody can relate to, right? Why did you get into nursing? What is that connection that really draws you to this profession? In addition to once you get into an organization, just be open to learning different things from different people and then taking that and kind of making it your own, if you will, later, but being open to different perspectives as people teach you in different ways. And again, I think just building those authentic relationships is really key. You know, we all have to address our own differences and own them, but it doesn't mean because we're different that we can't work together, that we can't build healthy relationships, especially in the workplace. And sometimes it's just about starting that conversation, because communication is everything, right? So if as a younger generation, maybe I perceive something that was said to me in a different way, but I don't take the time to explain that to someone else, they may not even know that they've hurt my feelings, or maybe I felt like they were abrupt with me. So I think just keeping those lines of communication open is always the best advice.
Thank you for that. And so now moving on, there was another question that was placed in the chat box. And so I don't know if you guys kind of want to answer this now or want to wait till the end. But it said, what advice or tips can you give us as we start our careers in healthcare?
This is Kamisha. So I would just say, just continue pursuing your education and strive to be successful. And you just, that's however you measure your success. And just try to find something that makes you happy and you feel that will be a good fit for you and your personality. If you have an opportunity to network or shadow someone, take the opportunity, because there are plenty of them available in healthcare, and you just may never know what's out there for you if you don't take that step to network with someone or shadow people or do, you know, research different things, learn different topics or whatever. But yeah, just take advantage of everything that's presented to you, or not everything, but the things that you think would be most beneficial to you.
Just to piggyback on what Kamisha mentioned, a lot of times I just encourage nursing students or people looking to come into the hospital setting and healthcare to join a volunteer program. So it might be like a student association or a community association that can also come into that healthcare environment to, you know, just see what it's like. Because sometimes you don't know until you step into a setting if it's really where you feel that you're going to best fit, as Kamisha said. So any opportunities to volunteer is always, I think, a great opportunity to see what that particular healthcare setting is like.
Any other comments for that? That was really great feedback. I'm a strong believer in advancing yourself and doing anything that you need to do in order to go forward. So I completely agree. All right. So the next question that we have is that, what are some ways students should go about identifying an advocate or a mentor in their field? And do you recommend having a mentor who identifies like you?
I mean, from my perspective, and sorry, my dogs might start barking. Just find somebody that's strong, like find somebody that seems to enjoy what they're doing and that seems to be staying busy with what they're doing and actually trying to build on what they're doing, you know, like that's probably the person you want to line yourself up with. They're going to teach you the most. They're going to help you figure out, you know, who you want to be. You know, you might see something that you don't like that they do that you might want to change. You know, it doesn't always have to be something in that direction, but I would just say find a strong person. You know, if that's who you want to mentor you. I mean, my PEDS rotation ended up hiring me straight out of PT school, and then she was my boss for a few years, and now she's a director, so she's still my mentor. So I mean, that's who I kind of lean back on. And I mean, I have a new direct boss now, but I still, you know, tap into her knowledge from here and there. So just find that person that you mesh well with. As far as identifying with them, you know, there's different ways to identify with somebody. So just, you know, find somebody that you mesh well with and can communicate with at a comfortable level and probably be a pretty successful relationship.
Just to add to what, this is Kamisha, just to add to what Tammy said, I agree with everything that she said. And also maybe if they're like, I don't know if you have different groups or not necessarily student-led groups, but like the movers and shakers. I don't know if you do that in the civilian sector, but we do it in the military. I'm just finding like those go-getters, people who are like achieving some of the things that you might be interested in, and see if they'd be willing to mentor you. And then, as far as finding, I think having more than one mentor is great. And having someone who identifies the same as you do, I think is good. It does help for you to help allow you to get along better with them. But at the same time, it doesn't hurt to have someone who may think a little differently than you, because then they also bring a different perspective.
I agree with what everyone has said so far. I'm definitely shadowing in a variety of practice settings, possibly even finding a job within a company that you're interested in as office staff or as a tech could be very beneficial. That's kind of how I started my journey into becoming an occupational therapist. I was actually business support and an interpreter for early childhood intervention. That's what led me to figure out what OT even was. And then as I was going out and interpreting for families, I was able to really network with one of the occupational therapists who has been my mentor and great friend since, well, years ago now. But I think, you know, just put yourself in those positions where you can network and you can possibly befriend someone to teach you what they know. And kind of piggybacking on what Kamisha said as well, you know, just someone who's strong, someone who's passionate, and that will lead you to the goals that you are also searching for, you know, the goals that you want to achieve as well.
And I agree, not much more to add, but just wanted to say that a lot of times I find, you know, my biggest naysayers are those people that I'm constantly having to try to win over. Building those relationships with them often gives you a mentor and a different perspective that you hadn't thought about. And once you build that relationship and that bridge, you know, you really start to get to know each other and learn all the other things about one another or from one another. So I really try to, if I have a difficult personality that I'm working with, try to mentor and nurture that relationship. So that way we can get over that hump. And that's usually always worked really well for me, because then I have more winners on my team and less barriers or difficult personalities to work with. So don't be afraid at the same time to, you know, look for someone who is maybe has opposite opinions from you, or is just opposite from you in personality traits, ethnicity, religion, et cetera, because you will learn a lot from those conversations of just opening that door and building that relationship.
Thank you for that. And so I do have a follow-up question as far as like for the mentorship and things like that. And so in your perspective workspaces, are there mentorship programs for, you know, upcoming, you know, new grads and things like that? So if you're graduating from healthcare administration program, you know, Kamisha, would it be, you know, is it ideal to have, you know, a mentorship program? And like I said, for all of you, is something in place to kind of help the upcoming as they are, you know, onboarding?
I think that that's a great idea. We actually have a program similar to that for like our junior officers. They ask us to find mentors, and I'm pretty sure like the senior folks will offer that mentorship for the junior officers. But we do have a program. They ask you who's your mentor. You don't have to have just one, but it's just like a little program they follow. You meet with them. When we do our performance reviews, you contact your mentor and just consult with them and let them see what you have. And they just kind of give you that guidance along the way. But I do think it's good to have that, because it's like leading you, you know, just kind of bringing them along the path and just helping the next group that's coming along.
I think it's very important once you are a new grad and you're licensed and you're looking for your first position to really ask that company what their mentorship program is like. Do they have a mentorship program? Because it's very essential, especially during your first year being a practitioner. You want to learn from others. You want to be able to reach out to others. And like in my experience, I was very fortunate to have my immediate boss be my mentor. And we do offer a mentorship program as well. And so that has really helped me to learn, to be more confident, to just propel my career forward as I had wanted to. So I think, you know, especially in that interview process, when you're ready to, you know, get that job, ask about that mentorship program. Do you offer mentorship? What does that look like? What does that entail? Because it's, you know, in any interview, you're interviewing each other. So always remember that. I think that's one of the key things.
From our attendees, do we have any questions from you all? Once again, if you have questions, go ahead and place those in the chat box. And so we will move it right along. And so this next question, we're going to get into some DEI stuff. And so, like I said, we'll continue that conversation. And so this question is, how do we make a more inclusive environment for gender non-conforming or transgender healthcare professionals?
I think education. Education is the best thing that we can do. Educating yourself, educating your peers, educating people who may hold some kind of discriminatory view against, you know, people that are gender non-conforming, because truthfully, we need everyone in our workforce. We need everyone in our fields. In order for people to be able to receive the care that they need, we need to be diverse and we need to respect others. So I think to be more inclusive, just educate yourself and address people how they want to be addressed. You know, it all goes back to that simple old saying we've always heard, treat others how you want to be treated, right? So respect and educate.
I agree with what Mia said, of course, as an educator, but I think at the same time, I'd add just partnering with those people that you do identify within your healthcare organization or within your profession to learn from them. Because I think like everything else in life, they're the experts of being able to question and ask, you know, what's important to you? How do you prefer to be treated? What are the biases that you've witnessed and how can we make this better? I think including those people in the conversation in every work setting is important, just because, again, we have our own biases sometimes that we don't even recognize on our own. And so just hearing from those experts in the field and colleagues that we work with, I think is always the best source. But yes, there can't be enough communication and education from my perspective on the topic. And any organization that I would, you know, be interviewing for, thinking about joining, I definitely would ask those questions, because I think if, you know, an organization right now doesn't have a DEI initiative, then that would be something that would cause me to really ask a lot more questions and dig deeper as to why that is and if that company's values really align with my own, because you don't want to get into a work setting where you have an ethical dilemma, right? Where maybe your beliefs don't align with that company. You want to know that up front. And so, yeah, those are absolutely great questions to always ask in your interviews.
And so going back to talking about mentors, we do have a question that was placed in the chat box. It says, if you decide to have two mentors, how do you balance or manage the two different approaches from each of them?
So for me, it's really about, before I even ask someone, I kind of have a good idea of their personality and maybe how they would take me approaching them, because not more than likely we're kind of in the same group because of my specialty. So I tend to use like other healthcare, senior healthcare administrators, because they're the ones that have the most insight into how I can advance in my career. But really, I just try to figure out that person and their personality type, what they would accept as far as me emailing them or coming up to them. I just try to establish some type of relationship with them. And then I ask, but most of them are like willing to mentor. From what I've found is that most people will appreciate you wanting that mentorship from them.
And so the next question is, how do you handle conflict in a mentorship or on the job? And who do you go to if that arises?
So I haven't had conflict with any of my mentors. They're pretty senior. So, but if I did have any issues, I feel like with the ones that I picked, I can just go to them and talk to them. I mean, just be respectful about it. And they, most of the time, they're willing to listen and resolve whatever issues you have. As far as any conflict, like it's in the workplace, it really depends on what type of conflict it is. I think it's better to calmly, you know, discuss with whoever you're having that conflict with. If that doesn't work, it's probably best to have like that mediator, someone else there, so that you can just kind of have a good a mediator, basically, or if it gets to the point where you can't resolve the issue at that level, then you may have to go to whoever's in charge, like your next line, you know, follow the structure, you know, like we call it chain of command. I don't know if that's what you call it in the civilian sector, but basically just try to work that and keep everyone informed. But I would start at the lowest level if possible. Sometimes you can't. So that's when you need to get other people involved.
And so then the next question is, we have a couple of questions in the chat box. So shout out and kudos to all of you that are asking questions. And so one of the questions is, do you have any advice on how to network with others while we are in the midst of COVID or social distancing? And so Hannah said that she thinks that there has been a significant shift from in-person events to virtual that have made networking more difficult. So do you guys have any advice on how to, you know, network in a virtual setting or a virtual space?
I mean, I definitely agree that it's definitely changed the way that we network, you know, in any setting, regardless of healthcare or non. The best advice I have is join those virtual events as much as you can, and don't be afraid to speak up. You know, sometimes it's intimidating like this to be able to, you know, say what you want to say or ask a question or, you know, have maybe an offline chat with someone. But I think just putting yourself out there to, you know, let people get to know you is the first step. And then, you know, if you find somebody just like in today's setting that you meet and you want to know more about them, or maybe you want to foster that relationship, don't be afraid to reach out separately, send them a message to ask if they'd be okay with sharing email or, you know, how they would like to connect and network. Because it is harder. It's not as easy as being in a social setting, at least for most people, because you feel like you're more on the spot when you're in a virtual setting than maybe in a crowded room. Although others could feel, you know, the opposite. But just be able to speak up, I think, is the number one step, and share a little bit about yourself. And that gives people the opportunity to get to know you and then open up about themselves as well. So I'd say that's the first step.
And so now we have some, because you guys kind of covered, like, you know, what are some recommendations for, you know, our upcoming students when they should consider, like, those DEI initiatives, like, as a part of their job search. And so going now to the job search, can you all share any trends that you all currently see in the workforce that our students should be aware of? So pretty much just now, you know, what are some of the things that you guys are maybe experiencing, some of the things that you maybe are seeing that our students should definitely, you know, prepare for, or, you know, if they can't prepare for it, just kind of what are some of those things that they should look for?
They may be able to talk to a recruiter, honestly, because they can kind of tell you what the job is looking for. For example, like with me, I might get people that contact me, but sometimes they may not have all of the qualifications that we need. And so I think just play around with the job search and see what the requirements are, talk to a recruiter or someone, just even if you don't want that specific job, just to get an idea of what they're looking for. Because we kind of tailor our search based off of the economy, really. So I see a shift in what we're looking for more, like certain types of nurses, you know, so I'm assuming that maybe the civilian sector is seeing the same thing, like with the shortage in nursing. So I think just look at some of the job notices that are out there, but it does change. Just like with COVID, it just kind of changed a lot of things. So you just never really know how the job market will be a year from now or 2 years from now.
All right, anybody else would like to share? Okay.
I was just gonna say, in addition to that, I think from my perspective, a lot of organizations are looking for just culture fit, you know? So again, I think being open and being prepared to speak about who you are and what drives your passion for, you know, whichever profession in healthcare it is that you're pursuing is important. Because, you know, depending, like Kamisha mentioned, depending on the time, there may be a surplus or a shortage of particular individuals applying for that position. So I think it really helps to stand out by just giving your why and being able to share about yourself. Because that interview, as Mia mentioned before, is both ways. You know, they're trying to get to know you and you them as well to make sure it's a good fit. And so regardless of technical skills, especially where we are now in nursing, where we have a lot of new graduates, everyone's kind of coming out, you know, with the same baseline experience, unless you've had a second career or something like that, or you've volunteered or gotten a tech job or something. You know, majority of nursing students have the same baseline competency. So what we're really looking for is, does this person fit the culture of our organization? And do we feel like they're going to be able to be successful and really commit to us and be able to retain that person?
Okay. And so Jennifer, going back to your statement about being, you know, meeting the culture or, you know, culture fit, can you kind of elaborate on that just a little bit more so that, you know, our students can kind of understand that a little bit better?
Yeah. Thanks for asking, Olivia. So I think doing your research before you go into an interview is really important. You know, you want to get to know what that organization is about. So you want to look at their mission statement. You want to look at any like community statistics that you can to know who is it that they really serve and what is their purpose in healthcare. Because again, as we mentioned before, you want to make sure both those align with your own values and your goals and achievements in your own career, but as well as making sure that you're prepared to speak to how you will fit into that culture. So I think just digging into those details before an interview really can make a difference.
Thank you for that. Was there any other comments about the job search? Okay. And so another question that was placed is, as a female, how should females avoid illegal interview questions? And so a lot of times I know when, you know, Trevor and myself, when we're meeting with our students and we're going over interviewing and doing mock interviews and just kind of taking them through those different elements of what, you know, preparing them for their interview. How should females avoid those illegal interview questions? And so if they experience illegal interview questions, then how should one report that information? So, you know, illegal interview questions or red flags, meaning like if they're asking you questions about whether or not, like, well, are you pregnant or are you with child? Well, what national, like, what's your race or what do you identify as? So I guess you could say kind of just explain, you know, how should, you know, women avoid those illegal interview questions or how can they kind of navigate away from them if one comes up?
Well, I guess a lot of times you can't necessarily avoid what comes out of somebody else's mouth, right? But I will say a lot of times during an interview, things can get a little bit casual and they start talking about their family or they did this or they did that. So when somebody starts talking about family, you know, they might ask you the question, do you have kids? And, you know, it's like a roundabout way of getting you to say something. And you say, well, you can answer it how you want to answer it, but you know, just finding a way to redirect it back to the professional side of, you know, the conversation. Just, I don't, but, you know, in this line of work, I'd like to, you know, see patients that do this and this and this. Is this what I'll see on a daily basis? You know, just find a way around it. As far as reporting, I honestly don't know. I would go to my superior and ask them who to report it to.
What about you, Mia?
Oh, that's a tough question. I don't think that I've had anything like that asked before in an interview, but I think, you know, redirection is going to be the best thing to do. So for example, if somebody does kind of like Tammy said, if somebody just in a roundabout way asks you if or says that they have children, you get to have experience working with children without really revealing if you have, if you're not comfortable with that, if you know, if you do have children. So trying to redirect it in a way where you are relying more on your experience as a professional versus your own personal life. I think that's the way that I would address it. Now, if it's, you know, something that is a little bit more challenging, you know, for example, somebody's asking you more about your race or things along those lines, I would definitely report that to the recruiter, to report that to whoever is above them. That's, it's just not appropriate to be asking those types of questions.
And so I do have a question about like interviewing and things like that. So Kamisha, being a, you know, of course, a woman of color, what are some of the things that you've experienced, like, you know, in your field or, you know, as you were upcoming, like, were there certain things that you've experienced, you know, by being a woman of color? Like, was it hard for you? Was it a challenge? Did you kind of have to go a little bit further to kind of put yourself out there to kind of be where you are now?
So for luckily, like being in the medical field in the Navy, there are a lot. I mean, it's very diverse. So I was never ever just like one of, you know, a few. There were a few, a lot of us, not just, you know, like just different races. So it was I never really felt like I had to do more. Now, I will say there was probably one time where, yes, I probably did feel that way. There was nothing like just outright where I could pinpoint, but you just kind of know, like you can kind of see the difference in how you might be treated or what's provided to you, different opportunities, just anything, or what you're questioned about some of the things that you do. So I have had some instances like that. And I did feel like I have to go above and beyond to kind of just show like, you know, I'm capable of doing this. And it doesn't happen often, I will say that. So I'm grateful for that. But I've had some instances like that. And honestly, I didn't address it because, I mean, I had nothing to just, you know, flat out like, this is it. But it's just, you know, you have that feeling. I would just say if you're ever in a situation where you know for sure where you can prove that this is, you're being discriminated against, definitely take that up to your leadership, who the person above, if it's your leader that's doing that to you, go above them if you have to, especially if you can't go to them. It could be a misunderstanding. But again, for me, luckily, I never really was in a situation where it was just me, you know, and I'm like being pinpointed, you know, pointed out or just discriminated against just outright.
Thank you for sharing that. I think that, you know, of course, TWU is a diverse institution. So I think that, you know, sharing anything with our students as far as, you know, DEI or diversity, I think that they would love to hear that. So thank you. We have another question from a student, and it says, is there any advice that you can give for someone who is not sure what to specialize in within the healthcare field? Would it be beneficial to specialize in multiple areas of the healthcare field? And so, you know, either one of you can go ahead and answer that question, because we work with a lot of students where sometimes they may not, you know, be sure of what field they want to go into. They may not, you know, be sure of where they want to end up. So, of course, hearing it from me is one thing, but hearing it from the professionals, you guys are the experts. So, you know, this is your field. So what advice would you give someone who may not be sure of where to go or what to do?
I think shadowing is the most important thing here, and shadowing people. For example, if they were going into occupational therapy, shadowing an occupational therapist, but in various settings, shadow in pediatrics, shadow in inpatient, shadow in a skilled nursing facility, so that you know that that's really what you want to do, and that it's a good fit for you. Because oftentimes, you know, this is a big commitment. So school-wise, you know, financially, it's a big commitment as well. So you don't want to be in the middle of your graduate degree and figure out, hey, this is not what I wanted to do. Let's start over somewhere else. So I think, you know, network with people, talk to people wherever you can. There's even Facebook groups that I have seen where they're led by therapists for up and coming students where they can ask questions as well. So search out those types of social networking opportunities on social media sites as well, so that you can get a broad perspective of people, and not just in Texas, but across the United States, because it depends on where you want to end up. But try it out, shadow, ask all the questions that you have so that they can be answered, and so that you can figure out, is this the correct fit for you, or maybe it's not.
I agree. And just to piggyback off of what Mia said, one thing that I like to do, because I mean, just trying to give advice to like the younger like family members, I tell them, you know, try to join or go to do tours of the schools if they're, you know, of a certain age, or even you can even like go on, I don't know what website it is, or just Google it, like whatever specialty and forum, just include the forum in it, because sometimes you'll see that other people are talking about that same specialty and their experiences with it. I mean, you still have to kind of experience it for yourself, because so that if you can get into an organization to shadow someone, you'll be able to gain that firsthand knowledge. But I would just say, start looking at some of the forums of, you know, people who are also talking about those specialties, and it might help you out. I know they have like the student doctor form. That's just one I can think of, and some of the others that you can use. And you'll get a lot of information from people who have that knowledge and who may have gone through some of the schooling, and it'll give you a good idea. You can even watch YouTube videos. So there are some resources out there that you can utilize.
And so I think, let's see, we have one more question. And so, and we kind of tackle, you know, like providing the advice and things like that. So what are your recommendations for upcoming female healthcare professionals when considering, you know, looking, you know, their job search? What are some of the things that they should be looking for whenever they're navigating their job search? And so I know some of the things that we, you know, instill in our students is, of course, making sure that they look at their mission, their values, and making sure that, you know, for example, excuse me, here at the Career Connection Center, we're committed to diversity, equity, and inclusion. So we want the best for our students, and so we want them to get in front of employers that are committed to those same things. And so just what are some of the things, or what do you think is essential for them to consider in their job search, whether they're going into PT, OT, healthcare admin, or even nursing?
So I think we talked a little bit about this previously, but I would say, again, finding out what programs are offered for you as a new employee to understand the DEI initiatives that are happening in that organization. I would also ask, you know, how are the leaders that I'm working for or working with prepared to handle situations like this? Because I can tell you from experience in my own organization, there have been times where maybe a new nursing student, you know, a patient has a concern based on race or ethnicity, et cetera. And that manager's trained to have that conversation with the patient to manage up that new staff member and support them so that they understand, you know, that regardless of their race or ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, that they're competent and experienced professional who's going to provide the most excellent care. So I think just having those conversations from the get-go and inquiring about how are people trained, what resources are available for you is important.
And then I would say just kind of building on that, ask the questions about culture, because I mean, if you know, society is focusing on the DEI initiatives right now, you know, any company can put together a bunch of bullet points and saying this is what we want to do. But diving into the environment, the culture itself, it'd be a lot harder for a company to kind of you know, skirt around the edges of that. They could say, really, this is who we are. This is what we do. These are the kind of people we hire, you know, versus just some black and white, you know, ask about meeting people, ask, how did you create your initiatives? What factors about this company played into the bullet points that y'all created? Like, you know, that kind of thing. What input and who did you get this input from to like come up with this? You know, if it's a, you know, a room full of the same people, it's different than having a room full of, you know, diversity. You're going to get more value and perspectives out of a diverse group and hopefully add value not only to your company, but also to your healthcare practice, to the services that you provide to patients and everybody like that. So I think diving more into the culture of the company might be beneficial than just reading about, you know, these are their bullet point initiatives from the start.
Okay. Was there anything, and I know Trevor, he's in the chat box, he's asking, before we close out, were there any other questions that, you know, anyone would like to ask before we go ahead and end our panel discussion for today? Okay. But while that is happening, like I mentioned, on behalf of Career Connections, we would definitely like to thank all of you for being with us and sharing this space and this time. I know, and remind me again, who was TWU alum, meaning you graduated from one of the programs here at TWU? Okay, so Tammy, Mia, okay. So it looks like there may not be any other additional questions, but one thing that I can mention, so Tammy and Mia, definitely be on the lookout. I believe I have your email address. Trevor and I, we are working to put together a kind of like a chat and chew for some students. And so I know the university has like homecoming. It's a short, like, you know, a small version of homecoming, but be on the lookout. I am in the process of planning like a alumni chat and chew event where I will be reaching out to alumni from, you know, who have graduated from these particular programs. And so bringing you back and placing you in front of the students that are currently in the program. And so hoping that they can connect with you and speak with you about some of the trends that may be going on. And then also maybe just giving them some insight on what they should look forward to as they may be on their way out. So definitely, you know, look out for that email. And so I just want to say, like I said, on behalf of Career Connections, we want to thank all of you for coming. We want to thank all of our attendees for being here with us today. I do see our assistant director of Career Connections that is on the line. Her name is Lucy Moran. So want to thank her for being there. Hi, Lucy. And so Lucy, would you like to say anything before we close out?
I just want to thank you all for your time and your expertise. I've heard Olivia mention this before, but we can say things till we're blue in the face. But hearing it from you is the most impactful information and way we can help our students be successful. So thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Lucy. All right. And so, like I said, thank you all. And so our students are saying thank you. They are saying that they really enjoyed this discussion. So I'm hoping that all of you that shared this time with us, that, you know, you definitely took away something. Yes, the session has been recorded. So we will try to get this out to anyone that may have missed it. So once again, I want to thank all of you for being here. And Trevor, was there anything that you would like to say before we go ahead and end the call?
No, I think you all kind of wrapped it up really smoothly. So thank you, Lucy and Leah, for participating today. And shout out and thank you to our amazing panelists. Please be on the lookout for any additional panels that we will have in the future, or any recruiting events that we will have in the future. We will be leaning on you all. So again, please be on the lookout for any of those recruiting pieces. We are looking to reevaluate how we recruit and market for our students moving forward. As the pandemic has shifted a lot of things, obviously it's shifted the way career fairs have looked at as well. And so again, please be on the lookout for what that may look like going forward. But again, this session has been recorded and we do thank you all very much. And I'm gonna pass it back over to Olivia because my background is overly loud. And I don't wanna overload your ears.
All right, well, yes, like I said, thank you guys 100 times more, and be on the lookout and definitely stay safe in your prospective work spaces. And so the recording, I believe, yes, it will be on our YouTube channel. So once the recording has been converted over and everything, we will definitely upload it. So at this time, this is going to conclude our panel discussion for today. And as I mentioned, thank you all for being here. And thank you to our amazing panelists for joining in on our discussion today. And I hope you guys have a good rest of your day and definitely have a great weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us. Wish you guys the best.
Thank you. Bye-bye.